What's he doing standing there? I think he's staring at me. That's freaking me out. What's he got in the bag? Is there a knife in it or something like that? Flipping kids, I shouldn't be standing around like that all the time, freaking people out.
Why is that kid there? What's he at? Nothing better to do. Probably breaking into that building. Good thing I locked the office. It's a disgrace standing there with a bag full of drink, probably. Probably dealing drugs as well.
Are you here for the prize given?
Yeah, I've got the prizes.
There you go, folks. A few Oscars in the making there. Okay, so we'll open it up for the first question then for the panel. Hello, panel.
Hello.
The first topic was, I think, the space that we utilise in Belfast for young people, our space, our time. So basically what the discussion was about was what areas in Belfast are available to the youth and how are they being used and what opportunities are there in Belfast for the young people? Adam, hiya.
That's a question. I don't think there are very many. How's that for an answer? I don't think it's a very family friendly or very youth friendly city centre. I think that whenever young people tend to congregate, authorities tend to think that they're going to be doing bad things. Not just, I mean, actually, what you tend to think. What tends to happen is what happened in that video, except multiplied by about, somebody's obviously added me talking there, multiplied by about, you know, a council size. So a council goes, oh my God, all these young people are hanging out, they're probably doing drugs and having dirties and things like that. It's terrible, we need to get rid of them.
And how did you get involved, Adam? What is your role at the minute? I mean, how are you involved in this project? Oh, sorry, just in this conversation, sorry. Surprise!
Yeah, that's good to know. I do a lot. I'm involved in a lot of projects, but I guess I'm here because of Culture Night, which is an event on the 19th of September this year, and I guess the easiest way to describe it is last year we had 270 free events in 6 hours with 42,000 people at it. So it's a very big deal, and it kind of changes how the city works. I think that's why I'm here, because what happens is for that one night, like, Belfast feels quite different and quite accepting and quite sort of pluralist, shall we say.
Yeah, so you know how about utilising space in Belfast, basically.
Yeah.
Yeah. Awesome. Okay, thank you. And Aaron?
Yes, hello, I'm Aaron. I think that Belfast, believe it or not, below this beard, I am actually only 23. So I would include myself, I know, it's shocking.
It's a fine beard.
So I would include myself as a young person, as far as I'm concerned. I don't know, you can agree or disagree. But I think that it's starting to become a city where it does present opportunity for young people to develop their space. Organisations like Wimps, holding nights like tonight, is allowing young people to get involved. I work down at a place called T13 in Titanic Quarter. Has anybody been to T13?
Yeah.
Great, okay. So T13 is what's called a shared cultural space. And sort of 9 to 5, it's a skate park. So there's skateboarding, BMX, parkour, graffiti, all those underground things that for years were not seen to be cool or appropriate for young people to be doing. Sedan Square, just across the road, used to be the hottest skate venue in Belfast, and then pretty much solely based on the people who hung out there and what that sort of said about young people, the square was created into the nice flat Writers Square that we see today. So we're trying to sort of encourage everybody to come down to Titanic Quarter and create a community down there around those more underground sports and cultures. We also have a musical theatre there now, as well as a gym and hip-hop courses and all those kind of things. So it's beginning to be a place where young people can get involved if they so wish. We have tried to create a shared space in Titanic Quarter because for so long, you know, we talk about the flags and everyone plants their flags in their communities, and there's lots of programs that happen in West Belfast or in North Belfast or South or East. But that means that only people from there will go to feel comfortable.
Yeah.
Whereas we're trying to reach out in a new bit of Belfast and create a space where everyone can get involved.
Awesome. So, we do love flags over Northern Ireland, sadly. Okay, I'm sorry, you're...
Ruth.
Ruth, yeah. Hiya.
Ruth Morrow. So I'm an academic, sort of.
We forgive you.
I know. I'm quite normal underneath, but and I teach architecture, and I'm interested in the city and all of those things. So, and I have children and a young person in my family who's trying to come to terms with being in the city. So I think quite a lot. I'm more interested in spaces between buildings and buildings. So I'm more interested in what happens within the city, and I happen to be a big fan of T13, but I wish you didn't have to go down there to Titanic. I wish you could do that right in the city centre. So I understand T13 as being an urban space, but it just so happens to be internalised at the moment. What we need to do is externalise that and make that a space right in the city centre. So I'm interested in that, and also because I think about what the act of being in a space is about, being a city. So I think that we learn about cities. And whenever I was growing up, you couldn't get into the city centre in Belfast, only through shop opening hours. And there wasn't really anything else around that. And I think that we understand ourselves through being in a city. So academics tend to say that the city is a physical manifestation of society. In other words, it is physically what society is. It's a representation. But if you think about that, it's actually only a representation of the wealthy and the powerful.
Okay.
And not of everybody. So I think if you look at a city and you don't see very many young people in it, it's because it's not considered those people. And it's unlikely it's going to have a bright future unless those young people are visible within the city. So that's why I'd love to see T13 right in the middle of... I'd like it to take over the City Hall. That would be ideal. Yeah.
We're working on it.
Yeah,
you work on it. That's the next master plan. Thanks very much, guys. Okay, so what we're going to do is then we're just going to go around each table then and just get the feedback then for the panel, okay? So I'm going to start over in this corner then. All right. Okay, so should young people get in trouble for doing graffiti? Okay. You're like...
Right. Where do we start?
Do you want me to start?
Go on then.
Okay,
Semantically, there's a difference between vandalism, graffiti, and street art, by which I mean there are laws in a society for a reason. So if I was to walk out today into that square and write in spray paint on the ground, like, you know, I hate wimps, they're all, you know, wimps or something, that would be really insensitive and naughty and wrong, and I would probably get arrested, and rightly so. However, there is another level where art on walls, and well done, and not just basically vandalism. I mean, that's basically vandalism. And graffiti and vandalism can sometimes be interchangeable, but also art and graffiti can sometimes be interchangeable. So that's a long-winded start, but basically street art is really important in this city because we have a tradition of putting our traditions on walls and earmarking territory with big murals with really scary stuff in it. And what I like to do a lot of work, if you walk down North Street, actually, which is just over there, you'll see a lot of street art that I've been involved with. And I do that because I believe that it's shared cultural space, and it creates shared cultural space in the city centre for people, a non-commercial kind of brightening of what, in particular in North Street, has been something that has just been let rot. Because of personal reasons, we haven't too long to go into that. But yeah, a young person should be encouraged, basically, to answer the question, to explore their artistic side, and should be facilitated, whether it's in legal walls or courses or whatever, to explore that, and should be allowed spaces within the city to express themselves within reason. But writing up the insert paramilitary group here is obviously kind of bad. So nobody's going to say that. And sometimes the two, as I say, semantically get mixed up.
Okay.
Hope that kind of vaguely answered your question. So.
Have other two panelists any brief comments to make on that?
I would just say that if a space disrespects you, it would be obvious that you might disrespect it. And I do think that I'd rather see expression of individuals than a kind of banal built environment. So even if there are some things that are miscreant and not correct, I could forgive that by the mere fact that I would see the expression of those people who live there. So I can kind of overcome that a bit. And I'd also say that there's quite a lot of really ugly buildings out there, so I could live with some really ugly graffiti. And I lived in Berlin for quite a long time, and it's a place full of graffiti, and all the better for it. All the better for it. So I kind of go either way on it, really.
Any?
Yeah, I mean, I think it depends, as Adam said, you know, why you're doing it, why you're doing the graffiti. We have a big ugly building down where we are. It's a big old shed where ships used to store all their parts. And we needed to try and, you know, everyone used to come down and say, where is T-13? You say Titanic Quarter. And they'd say, okay, which one? It's the big grey shed. And you go, there's lots of big grey sheds. So we painted a 20-foot tiger's face on the front door. And now everybody goes, oh, why the one with the tiger's face? You go, yes. And it's blue and it's pink and yellow and it's not the normal colours, you know. So now that's a graffiti piece being used for a positive thing. And everyone, when you go into T13, you have to open the door that is the tiger's mouth and walk in, and everyone, you know, uses that as a way to find it now. So there's definitely positive ways to use graffiti. So should you get in trouble? If you're doing it for the wrong reasons, yes. If you're doing it for the right reasons, probably not.
But then again, and this will potentially link to the, you know, there was recently all this work being done in North Street, and on the news it was like, and you can see by all the graffiti in Garfield Street and North Street that it's really run down part of town. And actually, you know, pretty much everyone I know is going, so they're what they planned to do was to come in and stick like fake butcher shops over the graffiti, you know, and everybody's like going, what are you doing? This is like a disconnect between what most people think about that. And the graffiti in Garfield Street in particular turns over about every 3 or 4 months with new pieces and new vibrant stuff going on. It's not a legal site, but it's kind of almost become a legal site because everybody does it, and the police turn a blind eye and everybody turns a blind eye because everybody else can sort of appreciate that it brings vibrancy to an area that's really run down.
Okay, so hopefully I'll answer your question. Again, anybody, any comments on that, don't forget to use the Twitter. All right, guys, thank you for that question. Okay, we're going to move on to this table next, okay? So we're going to have the question from that table.
Okay. Why not have more positive stories about young people that aren't about education?
So why not have more positive stories?
I don't know.
Oh. That was a test run.
That's not fair.
Well, I have no
rehearsed.
Idea.
Well rehearsed.
You have to ask the media panel.
It's good to have a dry run. It's good to have a dry run. Oh, it's my favourite.
How can you make Belfast safer for young people?
Okay, folks, so how can we make Belfast safer for young people? Do you want to start on this end then today?
Flip, that's a really tough question. Safety is about more people being in the same place, isn't it? Mm-hmm. So it's unsafe if you're kind of on your own, or is it? Yeah, no, it's about more people coming to the same place. I think safety is also about transport. Now, we were kind of talking about being able to cross the city and whether that was a safe thing for people to do, and recognising that we don't have enough safe transport, so that from the age of, I don't know, what should be the goal in transport, that 11-year-old or 10-year-old can travel safely across the city? But we don't have that. That's not a goal within people who make policy or people who design the built environment. So I think sometimes you kind of have to set what is the ideal. So we don't want people to be trapped in their neighbourhood. We don't want them to have to wait until they're 18 to get a car licence to be free, you know. So we should start to embed some of those aspirations in our policy. And interestingly enough, Northern Ireland's got a thing called the architecture policy. And there's very, very, in fact, no reference to young people. In fact, there's no reference to people. It's typical. There's no reference to the past either. It's as if we'd never had a past. If Wimps or anybody wants to take that on and lobby, I think there's quite a lot of different policies around the built environment that we could get some kind of influence or statements about. Yeah, yeah.
Okay, thank you. Yeah. All right.
I think, so T13 is all based on this thing called the live it lifestyle. There's three main principles in that, and one of them is to live an active lifestyle. So obviously that's incorporated with the urban sports and the dancing and creativity side of stuff. But I do a lot of cycling in and around town. I don't have a car license. And whenever I used to live with my parents, I used to walk home. And my dad found out that I walked home, and he was horrified. And he sort of thought, how dare you walk home, because you're walking through their area, then you're into our area, then you're back into their area again. It's a cert that you're going to get beaten up. And I did it for 10 years and was never beaten up.
Look at the size of them, though, seriously.
It wasn't always this. It was 13. So, I think a big part about it is just living it and going out and doing it. There's a lot of premeditated ideas that older people have. So it's the people who are making decisions that would determine that our city isn't safe. I know that there are anomalies, and there are people out there who are not very nice and will cause a bit of trouble. But for me, it's about you going out and doing what you want to do, and that'll make sure it's safe, because there's nothing safer than you being there. So go out and walk home, and go out and challenge people to put yourself in a position where, it may be vulnerable, but that gives you a lot of strength through that, because you can then say, at least I tried. Here I am, I'm in my street, and I'm going to walk home on my street. And you just go out and do it. And once you start walking down the street, somebody will look out the window and go, that guy's, he's walking home. Yeah, I'll walk home too. Or I'll ride my bike tomorrow, because I know that all the drivers don't want to knock you off, Maybe I'll ride my bike too. So I think you just got to go out and start doing it. And then once you start doing it, people will realise, they'll go, there's lots of people riding their bikes. So there's lots of people walking home. We should do something about that to make sure that they're safe. And they'll maybe make a cycle lane or something. I don't know. That'd be a dream, wouldn't it?
Okay, thank you.
I'm going to just make a very quick comment about Culture Night. I guess the one thing that I feel really happens on Culture Night is that we don't getaways like adult nightlife into this little kind of box where we say, right, everyone who isn't a Christian or is over 18, just you go in here and get really drunk, and then we'll shake you up till 1 a.m, and then we'll throw you all out in the street at once, And what actually happens on Culture Night is we have families and people your age and like everybody, and they're all in this environment where there is alcohol available, but obviously it's controlled. And actually what you find is the people who are normally in that little getawayed like area, they actually adjust their behavior. Yeah. And they become much more family friendly in their approach. So we have 42,000 people out in the streets, and there's probably about 20,000 of them are drinking, but the other 20,000 don't feel intimidated by that particular atmosphere because of the fact that it's not this sort of ghetto where people feel like, this is not where I'm meant to be, So that's really important, sending out those messages that, that social, safety is all about social stuff and being allowed to feel social. I think Belfast is really safe, actually. Mm-hmm. I think it's certainly in the centre,
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much. Okay, thank you very much to the panel. Sorry we had to cut you off there. Yeah. We're going to go to Hinda now with the Twitter. Where is Hinda? Oh, hiya. Okay, so Hinda, you've got the Twitter?
Without a question asking to the panel, how do you think young people are being portrayed in the media?
We're just about to move on to that. That's okay. Again, it's another warm up. All right. Any other questions on the Twitter for this panel? No? Okay. Awesome. Okay. Listen, thank you very much to the panel. Okay, we're going to move on to the next panel and the next lot of questions there.
Thank you.
Okay, folks, so we're just going to move on quickly just to keep the time. Okay, so our next topic. Okay, so our next topic was the media and how young people are portrayed in the media. Okay, folks, so if you could just do a very brief introduction of your name and who you are and basically why you're here today. And we're here to obviously talking about the media on this panel.
So will I start?
Yes, you can start.
Hi, my name is Maria Doran. I am the ambassador for Young Enterprise Northern Ireland this year. And I was sort of thrown into the media this time 2 years ago for whenever I was on the Young Apprentice. So I suppose I have a little bit of personal experience with being young and in the media.
Awesome. Okay, thank you. And Karen?
My name's Karen. I was a Wimps coach and a presenter for 5 years. And regardless, I think I'm still quite young, so I think I have the perspective of having to make media and being in kind of that judgment of young people. So hopefully I can add that kind of perspective.
My name's Stuart Bailey. I run a place around the corner called the OEM Music Centre, and I've had a radio show on Radio Ulster for 14 years and used to work at the NME.
Cool. Okay, thank you very much. So what we're going to do is we'll just open up to the next table then. So it would be yourselves then that will ask the panel this question. Okay, no problem. So we'll move on to this table then. Do you have a media question there for us?
Do you think that young people are stereotyped by the media to be violent and to be the main cause of anti-social behaviour?
Okay, so do you think that young people are portrayed in the media to be violent and the cause of anti-social behaviour? So to start with yourself then.
I do think there is air of stereotype in the media. A lot of the media portrays youths as bad people who want to start violence, but the thing is we need to fight against that stereotype as young people and not let it affect what we are, because in the end of the day young people are the future, and if we let ourselves believe that that stereotype is true, then we're just not going to progress forward at all. We need to fight against that stereotype. In the end of the day, journalists are going to print what sells, and the thing that sells is a lot of rubbish. So if we just don't let it dishearten us, then we should be grand.
Okay, great, thanks.
I think in the media there's kind of two representations of young people. There's the good young person who gets all the right stars and, you know, finds the cures for diseases at 15, you know, that kind of like super young person who, you know, is kind of one in a million, and that's the only kind of good young person you can be. And then there's the flip side of the young people who are like chucking stones at peace walls and who are, you know, binge drinking outside the Odyssey, the things like that. Like, I take, for example, that concert where they had to call the emergency services and all these young people drinking. And then I find it quite amusing that the next day they were trying to say the pre-drinking, you know, drinking before you go out, suddenly this new cultural phenomenon has never happened for years, you know, that it's suddenly a new thing that young people are doing. I think it's easier to blame young people for things because they don't have as much of a voice in mainstream media as other groups probably in society, just because of the representation issue. Young people, well, now we're seeing young people organise and things like that, and you know, Wimps is a great project for giving young people a voice in that way. I just think it's about time, if you feel that media is not representing you, speak up about it, because if it's just going to continue on and fester on, if they think that these very two extreme examples of a young person is what all young people are like, which is clearly not true. So,
okay, thank you.
Yeah, I think there definitely are some positive role models, if you want. You know, when Barack Obama came over here, there was a great speech by Hannah Nelson, who literally tried to put politics, make sense of Northern Ireland politics for an American president, and I think she did a good job. I think you've got people like Malala, who's made a real big fight for education, you know, in an area where it's not encouraged to have an education if you're female. So those are kind of very inspiring things. I must say I really love The Inbetweeners, because it shows boys to be a bunch of idiots, and that's kind of how I remember being a teenager, really. So I don't feel offended when I say stuff like that. I do get offended when I see riots and people with hoodies on, and partly that's the media's fault, and partly that's sometimes stupid people with hoodies who give hoodies a bad name.
I remember over the summer as well watching the news, and there was the riots happening at the time, and I remember watching the video footage of all the people chucking stones, and they'd be really flattered if anyone thought they looked under 25, like, seriously. I remember thinking that, going, like, all these young people who all look about 30, you know what I mean? It's that kind of negative stereotype that it must be young people throwing stones at the police and all these kind of aspects.
Old people can wear tracksuits too, right?
Yeah.
They shouldn't, but they do, I think, is what coming to there. Okay, so I hope that answered your question a bit, guys. Again, anybody, any opinions, put it onto the Twitter. Guys, if you didn't have a question or anything, if we'll just go back to this table then and see if you have a question for social media.
I can hear that. Do you like how young people are being treated?
Okay, so do you like how young people are being treated, obviously, locally? Let's focus on that. How do you feel that young people are being treated in the community? Start with yourself.
Our politicians are mostly old. They're a lot older than politicians would be in Europe or in England or wherever else, and that's because we're a very stuffy, conservative, constipated culture in Northern Ireland, and we don't let people get on with stuff. There's always has to be some old bloke getting in the way, telling you can't do it. So I think that does affect how people perceive themselves, and I think sometimes you have to get out of Northern Ireland. I think it should be your duty to get out of Northern Ireland for a year or two just to breathe the fresh air that exists elsewhere, and then come back and do good work, because we just don't. It's a small place. There aren't a lot of opportunities. People get their feet under the table and they don't get out of the way. So, yeah.
Yeah. So I think the feeling from that is then that maybe, you know, to treat young people better in Northern Ireland, we need to sort of look at how other countries are treating their young people. Do you agree with that? I mean, what's your views on it?
I think that I kind of agree with that kind of conservative stuffiness that you get here. It's probably there's different reasons why we're like that. It's sometimes it's felt like, as a young person, you're just like, you know, stand in the corner and be quiet, and that's being good. And, you know, we shouldn't take that. If young people believe something is wrong in their society, they have the fundamental right to challenge that and try and change that. And I've had it when I was a young person, in Wimps and campaign. I'm still a young person and campaign, but you know that way. I've had everything saying, you know, people won't take you seriously because you're young and you're a woman and things like that. And those kind of comments made me more determined, because I'm just like, I'm not going to put up with that. I'm not going to put up with being patronised. I'm not going to put up with, you know, political dinosaurs telling us we can't do these things. And there's just, I think there's a real disconnect between, you know, this kind of social, like, liberal kind of thought of within our society and the politicians, you know, there's a real kind of disconnect between what young people want their society to be and what politicians are, and it's kind of just fighting that current of trying to get real progressive change here.
Okay. And then obviously yourself, I mean, you were a young apprentice. Do you think that you were treated differently because you were a young person, or do you think you were taken seriously, or what sort of...
Well, I think one of my favourite quotes is by Eleanor Roosevelt, and it's, no one can let you feel inferior without your consent. And life's life. People will tell you, you can't do this because you're young. You can't do this because you're a female. Don't listen to that. Because you know what? If you have... Pardon? Oh,
sorry.
Oh, here. Amen. And the thing is, if you just don't listen to that and persist and do it anyway, you'll be unstoppable. And I think if you let... Like, one of my... People said to me, Maria, it's a man's world, you're never going to be able to do this. And my response to that is, it's only a man's world if you let it be. And you're only going to be stopped if you're young, if you let yourself be stopped. Don't let anyone tell you what you can and cannot do. I think the question for today is not who's going to let me do something, it's who's going to stop me. And I think if young people all have that attitude, we should be treated fine. Cool. And I think we have a lot of hope right now in Belfast for the youth. There's so many great initiatives, like the one that we're actually at this evening, and like, I work with Young Enterprise, and the opportunities are there. You just have to seize them. And that's sort of what I think.
It's very inspiring. I think I'm going to be a supermodel now. Cheers. All right, so yeah, so basically what I think generally what the consensus is that although, yeah, we're maybe not quite there or we're not caught up with everybody, there is projects in place and there's things like Wimps and things like tonight that is helping progress. So I hope that answers your question, guys. Again, any opinions, stick it under the Twitter. And do you want to do your question now since you did a wee dry rehearsal? Aye, go on.
Do you want the real question this time?
Yeah, yeah, go on. I knew you were just getting us there.
I'll give you the right one this time. Why not have more stories about young people that aren't about education that are actually good? Good stories about young people that aren't about education.
So basically positive media for young people that isn't just about academic achievement. So I'll just, this is very quickly, just before we go on to the Twitter here, have you any thoughts on that? I mean, do you think that it's all academic in the media or do you think that there's more stuff coming through?
Well, I think academics is what, it's in every young person's life. I mean, you have to go to school from 5 to 16. Yeah. So it's a common area. But yeah, I think it wouldn't be a bad idea to push for more stories about not about education, because people educate themselves in different ways. It's not all through academics, and there's some people who want to go on to university and achieve grade A levels, but there's the university of life and there's so many other options. And I don't have much experience working in journalism, so I wouldn't be precise enough to be able to say about how many stories that there is about education and not about education, but it's an interesting point raised.
Okay, very good.
I think it's important to firstly highlight those important positive stories to the media, but if the media aren't prepared to pick them up because they would rather focus on the negative, I'm a firm believer if you want to vote for your fate, we'll vote with your fate, because your demographic, the 18 to 25 demographic, is what mainstream media is actually chasing at the minute, because if you find kind of newspapers and television networks and things like that, they are chasing you. They need you more than you need them, because this generation is a generation that have moved online. Instead of watching things like on typical like Sky and things like that, you'd be watching things on Netflix and YouTube and all those kind of other platforms. So actually, if you think about it, mainstream media needs you a lot more than you need them. So if you're a firm believer in that they only dwell in the negative aspects of particular groups, rather race, creed, ageism, and things like that, then vote with your feet. I'm a firm believer in that, and that's why I don't buy the Daily Mail.
Nobody should buy the Daily Mail.
No one buy the Daily Mail.
Okay, anything to add just about...
I work in music. That's what our building does. We have a monthly gig called Volume Control for under 18s, and it's run by teenagers, and they're on Radio Ulster all the time, talking up a storm. And we're visited quite a lot by people like Connor Scott and Andrea Begley, who have done very well from Northern Ireland, and they're conscientious, they're hardworking, and they've got soul. So I think there are other ways, but it... you have to work almost twice as hard sometimes to get away from those boring old stories.
Okay, so it's really just again about if you guys want to get more stuff into the media, then it's all about pushing it forward, okay? So, Hinda, then just move on to the Twitter with you then, see if we can catch up on those.
We got a tweet from Anya saying that the most frequently used word by the BBC in the media was neat, mob, and violent.
In association with young people then.
Yeah.
So again, it's that whole mob violence and aggressive description of young people in the news. Do you think that we are working towards getting away from that, or do you think again that it is still an issue that we really need to push forward with?
Well, I think there's positive aspects. The media are starting to pick up more stories about young people. They're including young people a lot more in content making. Like, I remember watching the news last week, and the BBC had a young school report thing, where it was kind of, I think it's like 16, 17-year-olds, where they were going to schools and teaching young people how to create their own content, blogging and things like that, all the various tools that are now available that weren't available 10 years ago. Mm-hmm. So I think there is change happening. It's just if you feel that the change isn't, I'm a firm believer that if you have certain views, you should be able to have challenge and criticism to those kind of views. Mm-hmm. But if you feel it's constantly just negative, 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 and there's very few positive aspects of it, I'm a firm believer in voting with your feet. That way.
Yeah.
So just, but I believe there's positive change, but it's happening. It's a lot slower than I would like.
So it's basically, it's young people's responsibility as well to prove. those theories wrong. That's the first statement. What do you think?
I completely agree with Karen. You know, we have to make the change ourselves. Mm. Those stories happened, and they shouldn't have. Mm. We, as the new generation, as I like to call it, have to learn from those stories, and hopefully they don't repeat again. Don't give them something to write about. That's what I think. And obviously, you can't speak for a whole generation of young people, but it only takes a few people to make change, and that's what I think.
Okay. Well, anything to add?
No, I remember years ago MTV did a thing called Rock the Vote, and they got young people to vote for the first time ever, and it was very exciting. And the net result of that really is that Bill Clinton got elected. But all the politicians had to talk about what they were going to do with young people, because there were so many people had registered to vote, it suddenly became an issue. So,
okay.
You know, register to vote as well.
Awesome. Okay, well, I hope that answers. That's pretty much answered everybody's questions there. Again, thank you very much to the panel for joining in on this. So thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay, so if we could have our third and final panel up then. Okay then, so we're going on to our third and final question then. It's obviously about, as you know, ageism, okay? Obviously, in society, homophobia, racism is unacceptable, or is deemed as unacceptable by a majority of our society. So the question is, why is ageism seem to be a lot more socially acceptable in our society? Okay, guys, so if you could just give a quick introduction to yourselves, what you're talking about. So start off this end then.
Okay, my name's Ross Brown. I am going to be standing for the European elections for the Green Party, for the European Parliament. Do you want me to say a wee bit about...
Yeah, just on the topic, yeah.
On the topic of ageism, well, I think that I've been both discriminated against, and I've been a person that has discriminated. I'm going to hold my hands up there, because when I was younger, I used to go to the ice bowl, and when I was a kid in the ice bowl, sometimes, for example, they would kick us out, even though we hadn't done anything wrong, or sometimes even they wouldn't let us in at particular times, even though we hadn't done anything wrong, because maybe there was a group of us. But then I started working at the ice bowl, and I became one of the people who actually then was told this is what you have to do, and this is how you have to treat younger people. So as well, you know, obviously when I went to school, things like when you go to the local shop outside of the school, maybe there was only three young people allowed in at a time, you had to leave your school bags at the door, and all that is ageism, and it's basically a case where they're treating younger people different to older people. And I do think it's wrong, and one of the things that I've found out is as I've got a bit older, I'm only 28 now, so I'm not that old, but I don't know if I'm still young, you let you decide. But one of the things that I have really found out is that, especially as I was going through university and actually doing placements and work experience with different organisations, was that I was really surprised at how little older people actually do know, and how much, you know, potentially younger people coming and working and with fresh ideas and fresh perspectives can really add to organisations, and how beneficial younger people are with their opinions and their views and their background and experiences coming with, you know, better use of technology, online, we're part of the digital generation. So I think that in that respect, you know, you have to look at what young people bring to the table as well, and that's really important to consider. So
that's great, thank you. Politician ready with a speech. Okay, if we can move on.
So my name's Tina McKenzie. I'm from Belfast, and I'm a businesswoman. I've been working across Europe for the last 10 years. Interestingly, across looking at companies and where they recruit their people and why they choose different groups of people in different countries. So it's quite interesting when you look at it from a young person's point of view. I'm also involved in politics, like Ross. I am part of the group of people that started up NI21, and I just got involved in politics about a year ago because I thought that Northern Ireland needed a new political force, a political group that was not about the sectarian green and orange. So that's quite exciting. I'm also a mummy of three children, and my 12-year-old likes to tell me quite often that I'm out of touch, so maybe I am. Mm-hmm. I'm not too sure. With reference just quickly to ageism, I think first of all it's quite humbling to be in a space, and so well done Wimps guys for getting this together, to actually sit down and talk to young people as equals, because all too often we're talking to our kids or we're talking to our relatives, and maybe we deal with each other differently, both the young people and the adults as well. Maybe we don't show as much respect as we should. But I think this scenario, maybe creating more spaces like this, helps us all understand that everybody's an individual and has as much to give irrespective of their experience. I do think though, and I know, that come when you get to the age of about 18, 19, actually there is more discrimination for young people in society. So you're going to get paid less money. And if you're in Northern Ireland, you've got much less chance of getting a job. And actually you've also got less chance of getting a house. So there's lots of big issues out there. And not to go deeply into politics, but there's also some great news as well. And the great fantastic news about the young people of Northern Ireland is that they're not stuck in their ways, that they don't have the kind of segregated ideas that we all had when we were growing up, and it's a different time. So it's exciting. I think it's an exciting time for young people.
Awesome, thank you. Okay. And yourself, sir?
My name's Anthony Morrissey. I've just been asked to sit on here because someone didn't turn up, but...
I think you're great.
But he really wanted to.
Yeah, so firstly, just to introduce myself, I work with Public Achievement on the Breaking the Cycle project, which is working with young women and ethnic minority groups. But personally for myself, I grew up being part of Belfast City Council Youth Forum. I was a chairperson there for 2 years. I then moved on to the Northern Ireland Youth Forum, where I'm still on their executive, and I worked there through those mediums, and I sort of owe my credits to the Public Achievement as well for giving me a full-time job as a youth worker at such a young age. So it just shows you that, you know, volunteering as a young person, you know, you are listened to by certain people, and you know, it's just about society noticing that and catching up. Mm-hmm. I think that the youth service and especially the community service as well. Just on ageism, I think it's important that notify that it does happen, and it just doesn't happen in Belfast. It happens everywhere. You know, and yes, I do agree that to a certain extent it is looked over, and you know, more things like racism, stereotyping, discrimination. You know, you have those campaigns that kick racism out of football, but there's maybe ageism within football too. Mm-hmm. You know, there's that comes hand in hand with it. I just think that it needs that pump. You know, it needs to come from somewhere. Public Achievement to run the votes at 16 that rock the vote, which is something that's looking at ageism and saying, well, young people should be given the right to vote. And it's not just them, you know, there's other organisations within Northern Ireland doing that too. So I think it's really important that young people get behind that to sort of really promote that ageism is an issue and it needs to be tackled ASAP.
Awesome. Okay, thank you. All right, we're going to move on to our first question, then it's going to come from this table over here, okay? So if we can have your question.
Why does everyone judge us because of our age?
There you go, to the point. Why do you think everybody judges young people based on age rather than maybe their achievements?
Well, it's a difficult one. I, like yourself, or like many people here, have been judged on my age, and I'll give you one example. Going out and knocking on doors just for this upcoming election, and I've had wee grannies come in the door, oh, you're too young to be a politician, you know, and I'm thinking, oh, you know. So I don't know, I'm not too sure why you get judged on your age, and I think it's a stereotype like anything else, really, isn't it? I mean, in the case of when you know, people get grouped together, and maybe there's maybe, for example, there's a perception that that young people don't understand, or young people haven't had that experience, so therefore they won't really be able to understand, or that their values and opinions don't matter as much as maybe somebody who has lived and had that experience. So there's all these stereotypes, and I think that's what essentially it boils down to. It's about grouping people together and then classifying them in a certain way, when actually the reality is there's many people in those particular groups that don't fit those stereotypes.
Did it shock you as a politician? Like, you probably haven't experienced ageism since you were about 17, and to be 28 and to go knocking on doors and to be treated like a 17-year-old again, did it maybe make you reevaluate your perception on young people again?
It was certainly something that when I'm coming here and talking to young people and hearing about their experiences, this still goes on even as you're kind of, approaching your 30s, you're still kind of being judged in that.
Yeah, I get ID'd all the time.
I suppose one of the other things that I would say is that another example of how young people are just being treated particularly badly, and I think it's really disgraceful, really, when what they've installed in some places is these mosquito alarms, where the only young people can hear them. Is anybody, other people out there? And you can only hear these things if you're under the age roughly of around 25, just because you're hearing, you lose it as you get older. But, it's an example of just pure discrimination, and saying that, young people should not congregate here because suddenly they're going to, because there's a perception that they're going to cause trouble or something. And I think that really, in a lot of respects, what it boils down to is when you're young and you maybe talking about youth unemployment, nearly a quarter of all young people don't have a job, and when you don't have the same amount of money, then maybe you can't go out and you can't access and go to the leisure services and go to the various places that you would go because you just don't have that income. So it's like a catch-22. You have to solve these issues, give people, young people, jobs and money and the ability to actually be part and participate in society. Otherwise, then you are going to have younger people with nothing to do and hanging around, and I think that's where we need to start tackling these issues as well.
Just because we want to keep moving on to as many tables as we can then, so just briefly, do you think maybe the media has influenced why people are judged on their age?
Sure.
I mean, do you think that could be maybe one of the most predominant issues, or do you think it is the behaviour of young people, or is it a generational thing?
I think it's probably a mixture of all of those things and some more. But to be brief, it's interesting that 50% of all the articles in the newspapers, when they're talking about young people, they're really negative. And not just slightly negative, but they refer to words like thugs and bullies and drugs and so on. Now, if it was any other group in society, there'd be something said about it. But I think the difficulty for young people is that you're not necessarily represented. So if we look at, we talked a bit about politics tonight, but I mean, the biggest group of people that aren't voting are the young people, and therefore their voice isn't being heard. Equally, we've got local elections coming up on the 22nd of May, and I wonder how many young people actually know what that job is. There's people in this room that would just be fantastic at it. Looking around the people involved with Wimps, people like you, that it's a job that pays a salary that's over the living wage, and it's about getting involved in your local community and helping. So I think that there are a lot of things out there that maybe young people don't know about, but equally I think there are, for example, the media, but there are also circumstances. I mean, we live in a society where young people stay in their areas, they live in the same, 90% of people live in the same area, they go to school in the same area, and when our young people aren't even getting to mix, never mind getting them to mix with different age groups. So I think we've got a lot of issues in Northern Ireland to sort out.
And very briefly, have you anything to add?
Just quickly, as I said before, it's not going to change unless you sort of get behind it. And, young people are looked upon as, it's ageism because young people don't think have a voice within sort of, politics that can really voice what their issues are. And one thing that I would say is just get behind sort of things like Wimps, get everyone get involved in Wimps, or get involved as part of, in a new form. And that is, get on those mediums where young people do have a voice, and they may be listened, and they might not be listened to 9 times out of 10, but that, that 1 time out of 10 that they are listened to, they really do make a difference.
Yeah. Okay, awesome. Well, I hope that sort of answers your question again. All the questions seem to have overlapped in this one especially. Hinda, can you just go onto the Twitter for us if there's any questions for the panel?
We have a question from Jody. Is ageism such a big deal anymore when you compare it now to the past?
Okay, so is ageism such a big deal now as it was in the past? So I guess Do you think it's got better than when, say, you were younger and you, you know, obviously you're 21, so it's not. But you know, do you think again that it's got a lot easier from when you were younger? When I was younger,
I am only 21.
Do you think? Alright, rub it in.
Do you want me to?
Do you think it's got easier for young people now, or do you think it's actually harder for young people?
Personally, I'm 41. I think it's much harder today than it was for us when we were younger. Mm-hmm. I think that with, you know, we've got access to so much information. We're all on our iPhones now. You know, you can see what's going on around the world. There's globalization. We can travel much easier. People see a lot more information. Mm-hmm. They've got access to a lot more information. Yet there's so much. They're so tied and limited in other ways. It's more restrictive. You've less chance of getting a job now. You know. And society is becoming more segregated, where people are less likely to mix and less likely to come together. So those walls are being built up. So I think it's tougher today.
Okay, yeah. I would say, do you agree? Yes?
Certainly. Yeah. I would say that there's, in terms of all, touching on exactly all of those issues, and there's just some new challenges, you know, the digital, how everybody's online and the internet is just presents an completely different context of growing up, and as you mentioned, that, you know, our communities aren't the same anymore. You know, people are working longer, they're working harder, and they don't have even the same time for their families and stuff as well. So I think that in that sense, you know, and of course there's all issues in terms of low pay and that, and I think that for young people it's a very tough time. Yeah.
So there you go, guys. You've got it tough. But
there's a bright future ahead.
Yeah, using all these different tools and stuff, there's definitely hope and there's a lot of progression because there's so many strong voices even in this room.
Yeah.
But listen, once again, thank you very much to the panel for getting involved. Back to you guys, thank you. We'll go and take a seat. Okay, so that's all the topics that have been covered. I'm sure you guys, I mean, Twitter's still there, so don't forget to hashtag, use your voices, and use the Youth in Focus. And thanks again to everybody who organised tonight and everyone that showed up. All right, guys, thank you very much.